when people are recreating the outdoors, they foster an appreciation for the outdoors. And I know that they're going to develop into stewards themselves, which I think is vital. Everything we do, we're always thinking, what can I take? What can I get? We need to have a few more people thinking, what can I do to help? I'm a really frugal person, and I'm a super careful shopper. It's so easy these days to buy what's cheap, but I try to buy for the long term. All those purchasing decisions are critical, and if everyone did a little bit of that, it would surely add up to making this world a much cleaner place.
I don't know. I don't really know what drives me to kind of find something very new. I think I've always been interested in the concept of just standing somewhere that no one has stood before, being somewhere that no one has been before. And that's kind of held true since I was really young. And I think that the closest I can get to that is this never-ending hunt for the perfect line. You know, it's like there is still so much more out there, and finding something extraordinary that isn't easy to get to, that hasn't been traveled before, and it's, you know, it's taking that road less traveled. I don't think there's a feeling in climbing that gets better than that.
In my climbing, my dream is to find something new, you know, a place that is untouched in the middle of nowhere and has just amazing climbing. Chances are you won't find anything, but you might, you know what I mean? And what if you do? And what if you said no, like, no, I'm not going to go because I'm too scared that I won't find anything. And then 4 years later, someone goes and realizes, like, this is the best damn climbing in the world. And then you're just sitting there kicking yourself. Yeah, I don't want to, you know, miss that opportunity.
This sucks so much.
Just landed in Abacon and got the rental car. Nobody speaks English. It's pretty exciting that by tomorrow I'll have an idea of what those Google Map images were actually showing.
I'm prepared. We're going up there.
2 hours into the hike. The snow has come. It's probably 25 degrees outside. We still haven't made it to the boulders yet, but we keep on trudging. The weather is just too bad, and we have to retreat.
Welcome
even though I've lived here my whole life, it's crazy how much potential there still is. You know, the ratio is insane. There's so many boulders to climb, but no climbers to climb them. I was really excited actually to see, you know, if Paul and Niky were motivated to come down and to see what we can climb, because I mean, there's enough here for a lifetime worth, and I can't do it all, that's for sure. So you had to find your way.
Actually, a lot of hard work to develop a new area, and it takes a lot of time, and I think there's a lot of people out there that have trouble doing that. It's basically like going to work. It's not just purely climbing, and half the time you'll go out and the whole day will be spent cleaning a new line, building a new landing, and maybe on a problem or two, and you don't even get a chance to really even climb. So I like to get a little bit off the beaten path and see if I can find something new. And it's kind of more of like a creative endeavor, finding new lines, cleaning the holds, building the landings, trying to see something that maybe no one else has seen before, or, you know, just purely having the vision of creating something on the rock that from the first glance might seem impossible.
It was pretty crazy, the juxtaposition of being in Russia and then flying halfway around the world and being in Tennessee. In Russia, it was kind of like, well, am I gonna find anything? Who knows? Like, I fly and I get to Chattanooga, Tennessee, and Jimmy's like, okay, we got this project, we got this project, we got this project. And it's like changing gears. What five-star line, what five-star project are we gonna try today? I probably met Niky about 10 years ago now, I was always really impressed with his attitude and feelings towards climbing. We never really got to climb together until this trip down south, and he thinks just like me, you know, he's always thinking like, where's the next best line? Like, what's it gonna take to find that perfect five-star first descent? Having been to the South before, I've always been super impressed with the rock quality. The sandstone in the South is some of the best in the entire world. It amazes me that areas like Little Rock City and Horsepens 40 are only a super, super small fraction of what the South actually has to offer. And to find the new stuff, you just have to know where to go.
There's a ton of rock here, but it always seems to be on one line. One mountain range, pretty much, stretching all the way from Horsepens 40 to the Red River Gorge and even further. It makes it easier to know where the rock could be. There's so much rock on that band. Is it going to be that day that you find something incredible?
His dream line for me will be like Standing Star for sure. And it has to be like high, slightly overhang a red with the best holds that you can imagine, perfect rock and perfect holds, and the movements are to be like really balanced between technique and power.
To go check out this really nice boulder, and I had some expectations for it, pretty high expectations. With always seeing new walls, you almost want to dumb them down a little bit. They sound like they're going to be really rad, but maybe they're not going to be that cool. You always get let down with these kinds of walls, and we went out there to check it out, and I just remember walking around the corner and seeing this overhanging swell, 30 foot tall, you know, 50 feet wide, perfect holds all the way out. It just completely blew my mind that something like that exists. I don't think I've seen a wall like that anywhere in the whole world.
One day while in the South, Jimmy brought us out to this incredible boulder that he'd put up a couple years ago. It had yet to see a repeat. The boulder problem requires not only an immense amount of physical strength, but it requires really, really long arms to complete the crux move. Fortunately, Niky was the perfect person for the job, and it was amazing to watch him try it and eventually climb it.
You let me go just to watch me discern, just because it feels the same.
I remember running through the woods after Jimmy, and he just makes this sharp left-hand turn up this hill, and he's running up this hill, and I'm following behind him, and we kind of get to this cliff line, and all of a sudden, the cliff just like kind of ducks in, and there's just this perfect roof. He and I looked at the roof, and you know, we debated, we're like, does this thing go? Does it have enough holds? Like, what's it gonna take to climb it? Finally, everybody got motivated. It just ended up being one of the coolest roof climbs I've ever done. Last year we found a really cool roof here in Chattanooga. I was just coming back off the finger injury and I couldn't really grab any crimps. I could only grab big slopers. I tried it probably 5 or 6 days and I had a lot of trouble with a bunch of the moves, and putting it together seemed like it was gonna be really hard. So this year coming back, like, I've just been thinking about it so much. It has a perfect start, perfect beautiful wall, like everything I want in a rad new problem. And I couldn't believe that it was here, that we had something this amazing, this world class in Chattanooga.
Seeing the infinite projects Jimmy had found and watching him come back from his injury to take them down, I found myself seeking an area of my own. I'd heard of a place in Spain that was comparable to Joe's Valley, but virtually untouched. With winter quickly approaching, I figured, what better place to visit and continue the search than Spain? With so many climbers living in Spain and so many climbers visiting Spain each year, it seemed nearly impossible for an area like Alcañiz to exist. When I arrived in Spain, I still was second-guessing myself. I didn't know what I was going to find or what to expect. Thank you.
I started working the climb. I kind of figured out the top sequence pretty quickly, but what really eluded me was the very first move.
Kind of simple. It's like, are you strong enough to hold this, these kind of non-holds, or do you skip the non-holds and go straight for the good pocket?
The way that I figured out I had to do it was just kind of huck for this really kind of painful two-finger pocket. And I made sure that I had the top completely wired because I knew that the first time I stuck that pocket, I would never want to stick it again. I was on a trip with Chris Sharma, and he mentioned the area and said that he drove past it one day but never climbed there and was kind of blown away by the rocks that he saw on the side of the road. The first second I got here, I couldn't believe the quality of the rock and the amount of untouched boulders that there were. Every single day, I keep finding new boulders, and I just keep getting more and more blown away by how much potential this area actually has.
When I was talking to Paul about, I don't know, a year ago or so, he was looking for new unexplored areas around the world, and I was like, dude, if you come to Spain, you gotta check out Alcaniz because there's so much potential there. Fun to get out there and climb with them.
In the beginning, it was kind of, I'd find something, clean it, take my time, and now with a little bit of a crew here, everybody's super psyched, so it's kind of, everybody's doing everything at once.
One of the things that I love about climbing is the fact that you get to travel around the world, and that's something that has really shaped who I am as a person, all these different places I've been, all these different people I've met. And you might not even be able to speak the same language as that person, but through climbing, you know, we share the same passion, and we do speak the same language through climbing.
So easy to go to, you know, stay on the circuit and go to the areas that everyone's already been to, and it takes a lot of time and energy to go to these new places and hunt down these boulders, brush them, clean them, and climb them. It's a long process, and it's cool to see Paul out there really kind of pioneering these new zones. Cool to kind of help him locate some new spots and accompany him on his journey as well.
Breaks through the night screens to darken scenery, last wandering light. Broken lens caught up in a million different sides. A place and time and no desire to be found, I guess. Sometimes this place of bloom, when renewed from me and you, when recovered from the truth. Heavy metal bars around our tiny little hearts. Doing time in isolation, every single cell locked up. No chance of recontact.
On the first day here, I was driving down the dirt road and I looked on my left and I saw kind of this big farm area, and kind of surrounding the farm were these black boulders. And there was this one that just really struck my eye. It was this huge, vertical, probably 25 foot tall face. I managed to do the first ascent and I thought it was quite scary. When Chris came, it was pretty cool to see him step up and get on the thing and actually do it ground up, which was pretty rad and impressive effort.
There's a number of reasons why doing first ascents are more difficult than doing something that's already been done. You know, I think that's the main thing, is that if it's been done before, you know that it's possible, and you know that if someone else did it, then I can do it too. You know, and that really helps. And you know, when it's never been done, you have to really envision this thing that, you know, envision something from nothing and really have the belief to see it through.
It's been pretty cool to trek all over creation and hike miles and miles and miles every single day and, you know, find a lot of stuff that wasn't that amazing, but then find a ton of just incredible boulders that the process of establishing them and cleaning them and actually putting up the first ascent on them has been some of the best of my life.
Climbing is this very athletic thing, but the process of discovering new climbs is very much a creative process. And for me, that's kind of where climbing and creativity mix. When you finally climb them, it's so satisfying. It's like this interactive sculpture or something that, of course, the rock has already been there, but we're bringing this, you know, human interaction to it, and it becomes much more than just a random boulder. It becomes this work of art. Give it the flash go.
Get at it, dude.
You only have one chance.
I know. Good luck.
Wait, cool it a minute. I blew my flash.
Come on.
The finishing jug is guarded by this crazy kind of mono pocket that you have to grab with the right hand, pull really high and bump as high as you can for this just like perfect sloper jug.
For me, the process is just part of it, and you know, I obviously get frustrated when I don't do something, and you know, it definitely takes a toll. But I think over the years, I've kind of come to the realization that it's all a part of the process. You have to enjoy the process of failure. And you have to enjoy the process of breaking something down to build it back up again. And if you can't enjoy that process, then you're never going to really be able to climb at your limit, because you're never going to be able to put in as much time as you need to do something that is at like the utmost ability for you.
It's super cool to see Paul traveling the world, putting up all these first ascents and really kind of, you know, developing his vision for bouldering. For me, it's also been really important process in my climbing to really go out and not just repeat other routes, but actually go out and establish new climbing areas and really kind of develop what my vision is for climbing. And I think that's really kind of the way one can leave a mark in the sport.
The climbing in South Africa is some of the best in the world. When I heard about a possible quartzite bouldering mecca in the neighboring country of Zimbabwe, I instantly began planning a trip. There was no need to convince Jimmy, and he jumped at the opportunity to explore a new potential zone, and what we discovered was more than we could have ever imagined.
You could come here and you're not going to find anything, but the idea that you could find something and you could develop a world-class climbing destination really almost negates the idea of the risk, because if you don't risk coming here and trying to find it, you know, who's gonna do it? I've been on a lot of trips before where I've gone somewhere and just been completely hosed. The rock was crap, the weather was crap, but you can't give up. No matter how many of those crappy trips you go on, you kind of have to try again. Don't you wanna be wild and free? Living the life of your dreams.
I first heard about Chimanimani a year ago when Paul told me about it. He came out here last year for a few days to check it out and see if it was any good. And he basically wrote me like immediately after he got off the mountain, said it was some of the best climbing he'd seen. So pretty much like immediately I was like, come out and check it out.
We started going up this mountain. I thought, well, we made it this far. We gotta at least go see what it's like. We started walking down into the area. I was just blown away. There was just hillside after hillside after hillside of what looked like perfect sandstone boulders as far as the eye could see.
Basically about 2.5 hours up a mountain, living in a hut that has no running water, no electricity, no lighting.
We don't have a shower, we don't have a sink, anything like that. So it's definitely quite basic up here.
Every morning we're scavenging around trying to make what we can with what we have left. Make some like innovative way to make your coffee with like a rag and ghetto filter. It's pretty entertaining, that's for sure.
With such a big hike and with such a big expedition style trip that we're doing up here, we had to go pretty basic and we had to have food that would last a long time.
Pretty much living in the boulders, so it's either we can walk 2 minutes to our project or we can walk, you know, 2 hours to something. The accommodation is a bit rough, but when you wake up to this, it makes it all worth it.
Jimmy told me about this one really cool line that he found that was the slightly overhanging line that he said had a perfect start and kind of climbed up these really cool crimp features and underclings. And I got really, really excited to go check that out. And when we got there, I was blown away by the quality of the line and the movement that the climb had to offer. Coming back this year with Jimmy, I'm definitely blown away by how much we found. I didn't know what we were gonna find this trip. I didn't know if what I found last year was going to be it, or I was just gonna find a little bit more this year. But what we found this year is more projects than we could even try this trip. And we just really had to pick the best lines that we could possibly do in the 2 week period that we had and make the most of our time up here.
My approach to developing new areas and new problems is I want to find something that is absolutely incredible. So for me, when I go looking around and I'm trying to find something new, I'm looking for that. I'm looking for that five-star line, that thing that is stunning and stands out above everything else. For me, this is what makes me happy. This is the best part about climbing, the developing, the unknown, looking around and hoping that you find gold.
First ascent requires that entire building process that you don't necessarily have when you're just going out and repeating a climb and repeating something that you've wanted to try a lot. Yeah, it's a great feeling, but when you put a lot of hard work and effort into something that you know in the future is going to be a five-star gem that people are going to rave about for years to come, I mean, you can't really beat that feeling. When you do find something, I like to say, okay, is there a start? And make a sequence and make an idea of what's gonna happen. And a lot of times you'll find a starting hold and you'll find like three more holds and then maybe it blanks out and it's just physically impossible. And then other times you'll find a sequence and it's really easy and you do it first try. But then it's those climbs that are kind of right at that fringe of being possible and not possible are the ones that I'm really looking for.
Thank you.
to get water each day, we have to walk at least 10 minutes to the closest stream. So water is a bit of a hassle here. To do the dishes, we let the bowls and the cups just sit on the front porch. When it rains, the rain drops down into the cups and then it soaks all the bowls, and then we scrub them after that so that we don't have to use our precious drinking water to do dishes.
You wake up every morning and you have no clue what it's gonna do. Like, we've checked the weather and it says one thing and it does another. So really, we just don't know what's happening here. We're in the mountains, you know, it's pretty remote up here and there's pretty high peaks and you never know what it's gonna do. We've been waking up to clouds and rain and wondering if we're actually going to be able to climb. Every day we wake up, we sit around for maybe an hour or two, and the sun somehow finds its way through the clouds and the rock dries really fast here. When I go out hiking, I just look for something that looks intriguing, some feature that looks nice, maybe a big cluster of rock that might not look like boulders at first, but when you get in there, you never know. I don't look for just one single thing. I kind of look at a big amount of rock and I think, okay, I want to see everything in this field. Like, I want to see it all because I don't want to miss anything. I'm quite thorough because you never know. You might look at one side of the boulder and you have some trash, and then you look at another side of the boulder and it's gold. The whole process is what I enjoy the most. Finding that amazing line, running up to it, hoping that maybe there's something there, and then realizing slowly that, you know, there's holds. That's the beautiful part about finding new problems, is you basically find a blank canvas and you can kind of create whatever you want. And then eventually climbing it and finding yourself on top, that's the reward in the end. These big, beautiful things that, like, everyone will look at and be like, whoa, like, that is rad. They're the ones that I'll remember.
Yeah.
For the past few years of my life, I've been traveling the world searching for unclimbed rock, hoping to make memorable first ascents. I desired to have my own area, just as Fred Nicol and other icons of the past have. Returning to Colorado, I assumed my days of exploration were over, but little did I know the vast potential sitting in my backyard. I linked up with old friends to see what the Wild West had to offer.
So I think we're coming up on it pretty soon.
Okay.
If I've got the right pin, I'm not sure.
Yeah. Like rail sand?
Like, keep going.
It's gonna be like kind of around this bend here.
I grew up in Colorado and have been climbing outside my entire life. It seems like every time I return from a trip, someone is telling me about a new, hard, cool project. It's pretty sick to live in a place with so much amazing rock and a strong, motivated crew to take down the projects with. Growing up in the Rocky Mountains, it's probably the best case scenario for me. There's so much rock around, there's constant projects coming into place all the time, and the weather's really good here, like 300 days out of the year, so the potential to get outside all the time is endless.
Oh, there it is.
Can you get
it here?
If I could
come on.
Shooting star from
come on.
Yeah. If I can kiss the sun.
And baby, I'd be nowhere to be found. And it's a long time to lie. Travel beneath an endless sky. You could only reach so high. And I love to wonder why. Secret of how the world began. If I could own the key of life in the palm of my hand. If I could take you with me and slow the turning down. Then maybe we'd be nowhere to be found. And it's a long
doesn't happen that often. It's really hard to find new zones these days. You almost feel like the whole world has been seen and tapped out, and you know, someone has maybe been there at some point in time. But when you get to find those places that are just off in the middle of nowhere and amazing, amazing rock, and just such a fun experience.
There's a lot of motivated people going out, finding lines, and luckily the community's pretty good about sharing what they find. So there's a reason I've chosen to live in Colorado. The potential of climbing here is endless. The Rocky Mountains offers so much granite, all different styles of climbing. And I mean, I've been climbing here since I was like 13 years old. And even to this day, we're finding boulders all over the place. Some of them are roadside, some of them you have to hike pretty far in and adventure a little bit. There's no way that I'm even going to be able to explore all of Colorado's potential in my lifetime, and there's just that much. I think the cool thing about putting up First Ascents is the fact that you're about to go into something that you know that's never been climbed before. Kind of has that adventure aspect as well, like knowing if the moves are going to be possible or not, trying it out with friends, and just seeing if it'll go. And then once it goes, you've left your mark in that area, and it's kind of cool to be like, hey, I've done that boulder, and get people psyched to even fly around the world to come and try it. I look for things that are steeper, more fingery, require a lot of body tension. I'm a smaller climber, so I prefer climbing in a smaller box. Whenever I encounter something that's out of my box, it's a struggle for me, but I'm also psyched to do that because it just makes me better. So climbing with Paul and Dave really opens my eyes because they're a lot taller than I am and climb a lot differently.
I grew up in Florida, flattest place on earth, and I came out here probably about 12 years ago to go to college and rock climb. And I mean, what better place to rock climb than Boulder, Colorado?
And the screaming quiet. We swam along just fine, and then she broke her back, and her bank broke mine. Now I'm at the kitchen table putting numbers on the paper and dodging the mirror on the wall. And I swear I'd drive till the sun gave light and it just a little pushes off. And I build my boat so tall, so wide, but I'm still waiting on the river to rise. I was born by the brook. I keep my carpet clean and my money earned. Why?
I came to Colorado because I wanted to pursue a career in professional climbing, and I came all the way from Florida, so Florida is not the ideal place to live if you're trying to be a professional climber, so Colorado seemed like the place to be. I was really psyched that Hunter wanted to show me this boulder. I've known him for years. He is super into finding boulders, which is awesome, and I was just really glad that he thought it was a good idea for me to try it because it's an awesome boulder. The boulder is pretty powerful. It's a lot of like compression-y moves with some intense heel hooks. It's got all of the things on one boulder just by itself. It's kind of awesome.
Oh, tickets on my shelf, stains on my knees, pennies in my well.
I spend so much time traveling to places all over the world where people ask what that thing is on my back or what I'm doing spending so much time hanging out in the woods. It's refreshing to come home and live in such an amazing place where climbing is so widely accepted. So many people climb here, so many people are so motivated, and any day you want to go outside climbing, there's always going to be someone that wants to go out and join you. Climbing with Dave and Daniel has always been super motivating for me. They both have different styles than me, and they both have different strengths. And when I'd heard about this project that Dave had found and tried a little bit over the past couple years, Daniel and I got super motivated to go check it out. We spent a couple of days working the moves out together. Dave eventually ended up making the first ascent. Soon after Dave's first ascent, Daniel and I made repeats of Topaz as well, confirming it to be one of the harder boulders in the Rocky Mountains.
Weep for yourself, my man, you'll never be what is in your heart. Weep, little lion man, you're not as brave as you were at the start. Rate yourself and rake yourself, take all the courage you have left. And waste it on fixing all the problems that you made in your own head. But it was not your fault but mine, and it was your heart on the line.
So I've been trying this project up in Upper Chaos Canyon in Rocky Mountain National Park.
Buggy today.
It's a sit start to an existing climb put up by Dave called Leviathan Style. And basically this line adds in probably 7 moves of 8C into the stand of Leviathan, which in itself is a V11 with no rest or anything. So the whole thing's kind of this power endurance test piece.
Tremble, little lion man, you'll never settle any of your scores. Your grace is wasted in your face, your boldness stands alone among the wreck. Now learn from your mother, or I'll spend your days biting your own neck. But it was not your fault but mine, and it was your heart on the line. I really fucked it up this time, deny my dear. But it was not your fault but mine, and it was your heart on the line. I already fucked it up this time, deny my dear, deny my dear.
Come on, Daniel.
Yes, Daniel, come on, dude.
Come on, Daniel.
I've tried it for the last now 10 days or so. I don't know. Sometimes you just have to wait for the right moment and get lucky and just keep at it, you know, and try to keep a positive attitude.
It was pretty incredible to watch Daniel make the first ascent of what is definitely one of the hardest boulder problems in the world. Watching Daniel put so much effort into that roof motivated me to continue searching and to hopefully find something of my own that will push me to another level in my climbing. Throughout this journey, there's been a lot of successes and there's been a lot of failures along the way. But ultimately what I learned is that the failure just makes the successes that much greater. The past year and a half has lent itself to some incredible journeys, from the furthest stretches of Zimbabwe to the middle of nowhere Siberia. And it's crazy to think there's so much more rock to be found and so many more areas that this journey will never end.
Once it's done, you're satisfied for just that moment, just for like a small amount of time. And then shortly after, you find yourself thinking like, that was sick, but what's next? And that's who we are, that's what we do. So I don't think that'll ever change.
You guys smoking weed over there? So Topaz, so Dave, I'm drunk, sorry. better footing here.